साइंस पॉलिसी, जवाहरलाल नेहरू इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस टॉक ऑन ए वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यूज दैट इज हैज बिकम ए बिग इश्यू इन द कंट्री, दैट इज एग्रीकल्चर रिफॉर्म इन द कंट्री. रिसेंटली गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया हैज कम अप विथ थ्री लॉज, थ्री रेवोल्यूशनरी लॉ इन द एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर दैट वॉज मच नीडेड. एज वी नो दैट एग्रीकल्चर लॉ इज ए लॉ इन एनी सोसाइटी इज ए वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट टूल्स टू ब्रिंग एनी चेंज. वेन एवर वी ट्राई टू ब्रिंग चेंज, देर आर सर्टन काइंड ऑफ रेजिस्टेंस, सर्टन काइंड ऑफ सपोर्ट एंड अपोजिशंस. सो इन दिस बैकड्रॉप टूडे वी हैव ए वेरी डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्कॉलर डॉक्टर जैकब थॉमस, हु हैव द एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ द एग्रीकल्चर फील्ड एज वेल एज द एक्सपीरियंस इन इम्प्लीमेंटिंग द लॉज. ही वॉज द फॉर्मर डीजीपी ऑफ द केरला गवर्नमेंट. So he has a wide experience. He is an honest officer, police officer. He knows that how laws are implemented, what are the nuances, what are the problems. And in agriculture sector, which was crippling for many decades in India, and a need for reform was felt across the country. Many scholars have also voiced their support that something should be done to bring the change in the Indian agriculture sector. So today we are going to discuss the implication of these laws, that how these laws are going to affect our farmer, how it is going to unleash the potential of Indian farmers. So for these topics, now I request our rector sir to give a formal welcome address to our speaker today, Professor Rana Pratap Singh ji.
Thank you, Professor Madhav Govin, Honorable Vice Chancellor. Today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Jacob Thomas, my faculty colleagues, students, staff, and audience connected with the Facebook Live JNU. It is my privilege to welcome Dr. Jacob Thomas on the JNU webinar series for this distinguished lecture. Today's topic is very relevant as well as important in the current context, whatever current affairs we are seeing on day-to-day basis. I just, Madhavji introduced about the three laws, how they are going to affect the farmer community. We are going to hear today from the expert who has done his PhD from Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi, however also he has done a different area during his service. As we know about the economic survey of India related to these new reforms, if you look at their reports from several years, from 2011 onwards, or even before that, the economic survey of India has always expressed concern about the functioning of different types of APMCs in different states. However, at the same time, if you look at some of the reports and the recommendations, there also it has been emphasized that agri reforms are badly needed. How agri market reforms can be done? There were committees, one which was chaired by Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. There was also one task force. It was on employment opportunity, which was headed by Montek Singh Ahluwalia, and all of them I highlighted. However, we also know that our farmers, almost 80%, they are very poor, are the marginal farmers. So how these laws are going to benefit them, that is most important aspect of these regulations. Since there are some people who are expressing concern that these laws may be tilted towards pro-corporates and the government regulations may be weakened on APMCs and so forth. For this now, we are fortunate that we have expert Dr. Jacob Thomas with us today, who is going to talk on these topics in detail about these reforms. So with this brief remark, once again, I welcome Dr. Jacob Thomas for sparing his valuable
Thank
time
you, sir.
and sharing with us his thoughts.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Now I request to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to give the inaugural address.
Dr. Jacob Thomas, let me extend a very warm welcome to you on behalf of JNU community. Let me also welcome all my faculty members, staff members, and students who are part of this webinar. You know, since the last week of November, a section of farmers have been protesting against these three farm laws. And there has been a lot of misinformation that has been floating around. And it is very, very important that we reach out to the farmers as a society, as a government, and which we have been doing for last several weeks. But in spite of that, there seems to be some kind of attempt to misrepresent the farm laws so that the agitation continues to be alive. And as part of this farmers' agitation, we have also seen the role of the social media, how it can be used and misused to keep certain agitations going on. You know, in JNU, we have this tradition of discussing and debating on various things that happen in the country. And this is one such attempt to invite an expert like Dr. Jacob Thomas, who has a PhD from IARI, a very famous institute in the area of agriculture. And also he has been an outstanding public servant. We thought, let us hear from experts on what they say on these farm laws and why they are useful to the farmers and the farming sector in our country. We hope that webinars such as this will bring more awareness and better understanding of these farm laws so that ultimately they are implemented so that our agriculture sector grows and the farmers also become prosperous and contribute to the economic growth of our country. So with those comments, I would like to once more extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Jacob Thomas. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your encouraging address. Now I request to Dr. Jacob Thomas to give his formal talk.
Respected Vice Chancellor, Professor Jagadish Kumar, Professor Rana Pratap Singh, Professor Madhav Govind, Professor Neeta Soni, rest of the faculty of JNU, students, and those who are listening and have interest on this topic. 2 days ago, I spoke to a farmer in Punjab. I asked him to list three benefits of the new farm laws. He said zero, no benefits. Then I asked a farmer in Eta district in Uttar Pradesh, what do you say about the new farm laws? He said, I have no idea. I just heard that farmers are protesting. They are blocking the road from UP to Delhi. Also a bigger blockade on the Sonepat side. So going to Delhi is a difficult task. And he also said, when I sell 1 quintal of cauliflower, I get rupees 150. But if I buy 1 quintal of cauliflower from the shop, I have to pay rupees 600. So I get rupees 150, but I have to pay 600 when I buy it from the shop. So one farmer I spoke in Punjab, another farmer in Uttar Pradesh. Uttar Pradesh farmer has no clue what these laws are and whether that is useful or not, no idea. The Punjab farmer and the Uttar Pradesh farmer, they represent two types of farmers that I spoke to. Not all farmers, but two types. The One type of farmer is wealthy, they're college educated, they have businesses, they may also be aggregators or food processors. They have political clout. They may or may not live on the farm. And the other type of farmer is subsistence farmers. In India, 86% of the farmers are subsistence farmers or small farmers. They own less than 2 hectares of land. And they mostly live on the farm and they are poor. India produces now about 300 million tons of food. And our buffer stock is 57 million tons, which is 2.7 times our requirement. Our buffer stock requirement is only 21 million tons, but we procure and store more. When we procure and store more, there are a lot of losses. In Punjab and some other places, the storage is even on kaccha plinth. And there is a lot of losses. And even though we produce 300 million tons of food, our farmers are very poor. We hear of suicides at the rate of about 10 a day, farmer suicides. It continues for several years. And we hear or we learn in our schools that we should not waste even a grain of rice or food in our plate. But in our procurement system, FCA system and PDA system, we waste a lot of food. I was chairman of Civil Supplies Corporation in Kerala, so I implemented a paddy procurement scheme and also run a PDS, so I know the loss that happens in the FCA godowns and also in transit and in other places. And we have the Essential Commodities Act, which was intended to prevent hoarding and also to stabilize prices. But when onion prices rose, this Essential Commodities Act was of no use. So EC Act could not stabilize prices. And the price spread, as I said about the UP ETA farmer, the price spread is very unfavorable to the farmer. Farmers are not getting even 50% of the consumer rupee paid when we buy food items from the shop. And more value go to traders or other players in the value chain or supply chain. So unequal distribution of the value in the supply chain of food is a big issue that was happening. Shantakumar panel report in 2014, they said we should do something with FCI because they incur a lot of losses for us. Last 4 years, Niti Aayog is studying what is the extent of losses in the food supply chain. But they couldn't conclude. But there are several CAG reports and other reports which says there are a lot of losses. Sometimes it is 30 to 40% of losses in our present food supply chain or food grain management system. Should we continue this situation of 300 million tons of production and majority of our farmers remaining poor? Do we like to have or hear the news of farmer suicides? Do we continue to make losses of the valuable production which farmers spent 3 to 4 months to nurture and then harvest and then we lose afterwards? So then I studied some of the benefits of the earlier experiments of contract farming. There is a case study done by Harvard Business School. There's another case study done by University of Michigan. And there are other studies also, since they are from reputed management schools and external to India. I mean, they will not be biased, you know, I assume. So I studied what are the benefits of contract farming. Contract farming started years ago. Well-known model is E-Chaupal of ITC. And in Punjab, potato, chilies, tomato, Pepsi, and there are several other players are doing contract farming. Sugarcane farmers, contract farming is there, cotton, mango. There are several gherkins in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh. About 1 lakh farmers are engaged in contract farming. So contract farming is not new to India. Another aspect is private storage structures are also not new to India. In the year 2009, that is about 12 years ago, Adani Agri Logistics has set up 2 lakh tons of silos in Punjab, Moga, and also in Kaithal in Haryana, and also their field silos in Bombay, Calcutta, Coimbatore, and Bangalore. So 2009, Adani Agri Logistics set up modern storage structure for food grains in Punjab, Haryana, and other states. But our food grain production is 3,000 lakh tons. And the modern storage structure is 2 lakh by one private player. Is that sufficient? During the last few years, our government is talking about improving and increasing the modern scientific silo type storage structures for the food grains. But we couldn't do that. In that scenario, do we want private sector participation in improving the infrastructure in the food supply chain? Do we want more investments in agriculture? So I would like to discuss the three laws which were passed during the last September and against which there are protests. Some persons say there are no benefits, and some persons say they don't know about it. So when I studied the case studies, I understood there are three types of benefits from these reform laws. One is the farmer benefits. Second is consumer benefits. Third is development benefits. Now let us see the farmer benefits first. Farmer benefits, the first is these laws are supposed to give more choice, more freedom to farmers. They can produce anything, they can sell anywhere, they can export. There are no restrictions on their freedom to transact their farm products. So, and another benefit is that opens new markets. In 2002, we have a Multi-State Cooperative Societies Act passed by the Government of India. In 2002, we have thousands of multi-state cooperative societies formed since then. Suppose 50 farmers in Punjab and 50 farmers in Kerala, they form a multi-state cooperative society and they start exchanging the products, because Kerala requires some of the Punjab products like wheat, potato, and maybe Punjab farmers and Punjab consumers require the products from Kerala, such as black pepper, ginger, turmeric, maybe tea, or maybe some of the rubber products. So cashew. So all these things may be required in Punjab, and Kerala also requires Punjab. So similarly, different states, farmers of different states, they can form multi-state cooperative societies. They can aggregate their product. They can directly market their product. And that way, new markets will be opened even within the country. And of course, multi-state cooperative society can even export wherever their products or their niche products, like the Gandhagashala rice in Kerala or some of the specialty basmati rice from Punjab. So that can be exported to wherever there is demand. So new markets, when it opens, the net income from unit area, from per acre, will definitely improve. So that is a definite advantage to farmers from the liberalization that is happening or that has happened due to these three laws. Another aspect is when there are more buyers, there is likelihood of getting more prices. From the consumer side, I have checked up the ITC's Ashirwad Atta. Ashirwad Atta, Chakki Atta, the price is 42 rupees. Sharbati Atta, 62 rupees. Whole grain Atta, 57 rupees. So when ITC is purchasing, this is the rate. And if there are 100 such buyers, the production is only this much. The production capacity cannot be increased overnight. So definitely the price will go up. And when there are more buyers and also corporates who know how to manage supply chain and logistics, the cost will come down in the supply chain and the consumers also will benefit. The price may not improve for the consumers, but the price for farmers will improve because of the efficiencies that will be brought by more players, more competition in the supply chain and logistics management. But another is, there was no, even though contract farming was happening in gherkins and also potato or wheat, or chilies, tomato, and several other crops, there was no national framework for this contract farming. Now this law has made some regulations for contract farming. The farmer's land can never be alienated. It will be protected, whatever the agreement. And there are some dispute resolution mechanisms. There are some complaints and about that, but still there is a dispute resolution mechanism statutorily made now in contract farming. There is a framework, so that's a good thing. Another benefit is it facilitates electronic trading. Electronic trading was there for chilies in Guntur or for pepper in Kochi and also maybe other places. But then any farmer he or she can now get into electronic trading, and the farmer producer companies, multi-state cooperative societies, they all can make use of this provision. So there are definitely farmer benefits by higher income from this deregulation, and farmers can store any quantity of their produce because of the amendment in the EC Act. Farmers have no restriction in their storage. So they can store and maybe sell at a later date when the prices are high, and they need not immediately take their produce to a mandi or to engage in distress sale. If there's a contract farming, there can be staged payments as part of the agreement, as per needs. So several possibilities are there. Now let us come to the development benefits, which is for the nation. The inefficiencies in the food grain management, which is enormous, that will come down when private participation comes into the food grain management system. So we have seen in several other sectors when the private players came, so the efficiencies have gone up. The losses will come down. And another advantage will be the foreign direct investment or more investments in agriculture. That will be definitely good. And we need substantial investments to modernize our agriculture. I said 86% of our farmers are still in subsistence farming. Subsistence means they continue to grow in a very traditional manner. Even though Green Revolution states such as UP, Haryana, Western UP, they reap higher productivity, of course, at the cost of environment. But there are in other parts, subsistence farm is going on. So participation by firms which have high level of resources, both in knowledge and financial, that will be good for the farming scenario in our country. Another development benefit is more value-added products will come in the supply chain. There can be niche products, there can be specialty products. Our farm products will be graded, packed well, they can be branded. So now farmers, they bring in their tractor in a loose manner, their produce, and they are stored in suboptimal conditions. they are bagged, then a lot of labor involved in mandis, and all those things can be changed. Then we always rate our country on ease of doing business. These three farm laws, they definitely enhance the ease of doing index. So there will be more ease in doing business in India because of this liberalization through these three laws. Earlier, it was not, the framework was deficient in farm sector private participation. Another development benefits, more youth may come to agriculture. If the per hectare income is very high, definitely youth will come to farming. They may grow high value vegetables, they may plant foliage plants, floriculture plants, or they may engage in some point in the value chain of agriculture. Another aspect, development aspect, is carbon farming. Suppose a company is engaged in carbon trading, and then that carbon benefit is transferred to the producer because a farmer is engaged in carbon sequestration. So the benefit can come to the farmer. One company in Seattle, in USA, Nordi, so last year they did exactly this and transferred the benefit to the farmer from the carbon trading benefit. So in our country also, when the corporates come into partnership with farmers, farmers cover the land with green leaves, green cover, and that captures carbon, and that carbon farming or regenerative farming, so that will definitely is good for the nation, and that is good for arresting climate change. So the development benefits from the farm laws are from the farmer benefits, individual farmer benefits, there are benefits for a nation or for community. We have several development benefits. We hear some of the issues also. One issue was the guarantee on minimum support price. Recently, government decided that, you know, we pay directly to the farmers' accounts. And in 2017 and 2018-19 budget, the previous finance minister Arun Jaitley said in the parliament that the MSP will be 1.5 times the production cost. Now, the Committee on Agriculture Prices and Costs, they need to calculate the cost of production only and then 1.5 times. Previously, they used to calculate the parity of prices between commodities, price trends, environmental aspects, and paying capacity of consumers, several things. Now it is 1.5 times that formula is accepted. So that is there in the proceedings of the parliament. And that MSP is 1.5 times that, considering the A2 cost plus FL cost and C2 cost, that is promised in the parliament, and that is projected as an issue by the protesters. But when I study, and also the proceedings of the parliament, and also it is based on the MS Swaminathan committee report, so that is accepted by the government, and that is happening. So that should not be an issue, MSP. Then another aspect is where trade begins and where agriculture ends. That is a legal issue, because there was some dispute or debate about whether the central government has jurisdiction in legislating on a state subject such as agriculture and also marketing. So whether several points on that. There are issues in the central list, the concurrent list. In concurrent list, the center can legislate, and the center legislates as has been done, and then the state laws will not stand, the APMC Act or some laws will not stand. So in my opinion, the procurement was not a trade. Procurement was basically farmer offloads his produce for storage to government, and then government pays the money. So it is not marketing as in management. We learn marketing has four P's, like promotion and you know, several advertising and several other. The definition of marketing is not what the MSP and procurement and those things. So that's different. So in my opinion, there is no issue about legislation being done by the government of India, because it is not marketing. Then dispute resolution mechanisms, the section 8, 9, 13, 14, you know, there are also some challenge, because the SDM, subdivision magistrate, a farmer going to a subdivision magistrate, it is very difficult to get a dispute resolution done, and also payment in 60 days, that is too long. So those issues, the present condition is there is no dispute resolution mechanism. There is no law in the contract farming. Now, of course, contract act is there, but then for farmers, farmer specific law has come, and now a dispute resolution mechanism is part of law, and also a time limit is fixed. The mechanism or method or procedure is also fixed. And of course, there is a dispute in that section. The public servant cannot be prosecuted if he or she takes a decision on good faith. Of course, there is a general rule. If any public servant taking any decision on public faith or in larger public interest cannot be prosecuted is a general norm in our country. And that is incorporated in this farm laws also. So that is also not a big issue. Of course, those things can be improved. Definitely, dispute resolution mechanisms, we need to be done. It need to be done in a faster manner, more transparent manner, more fair manner. So that those are all administrative matters which can be done later. Another issue is the importance of APMC will come down. So APMC benefactors may be unhappy. There may be several benefactors, like the people who aggregate, the state governments which get some tax, the commission agents, then some of the transporters. So they are some of the APMC or the present system benefactors. But then should we sacrifice 86% of our farmers or 90% of our farmers' benefits and also larger development benefits for a few number of APMC benefactors is a question or is an issue that we need to think. Then another issue is hoarding by the corporates. So hoarding by the corporates, hoarding by the corporates is an issue which was going on even 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And hoarding, what they are hoarding, if they hoard food grains are a perishable thing, they cannot hoard for quite a long time. And they have to convert into some form of processing. And then when it is converted into some form of processing, the value will go up. So hoarding is food grain hoarding or horticultural products hoarding that cannot happen, because by nature, these products are perishable. Our food grains, they have maybe 12% to 15% moisture percentage. And with that moisture percentage, more than 6 months or more than 1 year, you know, storage will incur loss, especially rice that will reduce moisture and the weight will come down. For wheat, it may gain weight, but again, then perishability will go up, but the mold or fungus attack will be there, storage space, all those things happen when moisture percentage goes up. So I don't think any prudent or any company which knows business will do such hoarding in the present circumstances. So these are some of the issues which are raised against the three farm bills. And MSP, that is not an issue because it's already announced. Government is paying, and government has decided to make online payment also. So farmers should not have any apprehension about a guaranteed price. But with the liberalization, with these three laws, farmers are going to get more than the MSP. So farmers should look forward to get more than this MSP. MSP for wheat is only 19.25. But this Sharbati Ashirwad Atta is 62 rupees. So farmers should get 30 rupees for their wheat. So more than MSP, and also for other crops also, farmers should aim to get more price, much above the MSP. So MSP is only a minimum guaranteed price that should remain. And then if when farmers get more price, because of more corporates coming into the field, more markets getting opened up, there will not be much buffer stock beyond our requirement. Now we have 57 million tons when we require only 21 million tons. So that is a, you know, when money, that much money is locked up in kacha or kacha warehouses or, you know, state warehouses or FCI godowns. So that money is just locked up. And it is not locking up the money, it's wasted also. Sometimes the FCI storage goes up to 3 years, some studies show. 3 years storage means it is gone. So the hard produce, the production of farmers, should it go waste? It should never go waste. So some of the, as a way forward, some of my suggestions are, our FCI, Food Corporation of India, should be converted or should be transformed into a food marketing organization. They should procure and then they should market after promoting. They should not remain as a procuring, storing, and then, you know, offloading to PDS in other states. So that is not marketing. So FCI should become an efficient marketing organization, even exporting our food grains to different countries. And so our food grains will have new markets, and then our farmers will get more price, and the losses which we all incur because of the inefficiency by FCA or in the food grain management system, why should we suffer that loss as citizens? So that as a citizen, I do not want to tolerate losses incurred by any of the PSUs, any of the government agencies, because it is taxpayers' money. And as a citizen, I won't tolerate it. And none of the citizens should tolerate any loss, avoidable losses being made by any of the PSUs or government institutions. Another is more incentives to multi-state cooperative societies and farmer producing companies to export, and also to give credit to farmers at more subsidized rates, and also to have insurance to farmers or their farmer members. One Vilas Shinde in Maharashtra, in the year 2011, he started a farmer producer company. Now that company has 8,000 farmer members, and their turnover is 300 crores. So farmer producer companies and also multi-state cooperative societies, they require more incentives. 10 farmers or more can form a farmer producer company. Now the Shinde's company is 8,000 farmers strong. So when such strong groups come, farmer gets empowered, and they need not fear about corporates then. So they themselves become corporates. And multi-state cooperative societies, 50 farmers in one state and another 50 farmers from another state, minimum two states, they can form a multi-state cooperative society by applying to the registrar in Delhi under the Ministry of Agriculture. And then they can also achieve economies of scale and also transact in a very professional manner and bring substantial larger benefits to their members. Another recommendation is, as we said, about the carbon farming, carbon credits, the multi-state cooperative societies or farmer producer companies or the corporates, they can make use of the benefits of carbon trading, and then those benefits can be brought to farmers. So farmers need not be just grain producers. They can be participants in ameliorating our climate change. They can be carbon capture agents. So they will be doing a much greater service than feeding our people. So that aspect is a big possibility we need to explore. Another aspect is central universities and agricultural universities. They should do case studies on these multi-state cooperative societies or farmer producer companies or contract farming initiatives, which has happened during the last 20 years in our country in different states. And then through case studies, how such experiences can be improved, more benefits can be brought to farmers by improving the processes. And also if further law amendments or further policies are required through research, that need to be brought out. Another aspect we need to do, as in the beginning I told, I talked to the farmer in Itta. That farmer was very ignorant about our laws and he has no clue what is happening. He only knows about the protest that is happening and that is a traffic block, that's all. So an awareness creation campaign is essential to reach to this 86% of these small farmers in our country. And that should be in the local language of the state. It should be in Malayalam in Kerala, it should be Tamil, it should be in Tamil in Tamil Nadu, it should be in Bengali in Bengal, it should be Assamese in Assam. So the, of course, the subsistence farmers, they may not understand Hindi or English or, you know, the language in other states, they may not understand. So a campaign is required to communicate what is in it and what are the issues and what are the benefits to themselves and also to the nation as a whole. And my last point is we need to implement the change. Change implementation is a process we have started in the farming sector, and we should connect these three laws to Consumer Protection Act of 2019, where food is also included, and also Multi-State Cooperative Societies Act, Farmer Producer Companies, Food Safety Act. There are several other acts, you know, which should be implemented together as part of the package of change in the farm sector, so that our implementers of the farm sector laws, they should think of what are the related laws and what are the laws which should be implemented as a package, so that farmers will feel the benefit, farmers will experience the benefit, and farmers then will start talking about the benefits that they are getting. So I conclude here, and now I can answer any questions based on the points we have, points so far.
Thank you, sir. Very nicely elaborating the provisions of three laws. So I think if there is any question from audience side. Meanwhile, sir, I have some queries, sir. I think, sir,
okay.
Because we are witnessing every night, there is a debate, there is a protest, and there are some there is apprehension, in fact, how far this is true or false, we don't know. But there is apprehension is that once this law come into practice, in a, then Mandi Parishad will be illuminated. There will be no Mandi, agriculture Mandis will be gone. And once agriculture Mandis are gone, then farmers will be dependent at the mercy of the businessman. So whatever price they will give, they have to accept it. So once the government withdraws, then it will be totally at the mercy of the farmers. So how far, sir, it is going to be true?
Mandi under the APMC is existing in Madhya Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana. But there is no mandi in Bihar. How farmers in Bihar are surviving? There is no mandi in Chhattisgarh. So mandis are not there in every state of this country. There are mandis in some states, there are no mandis in other states. So that itself is a logic to state that mandis is not an essential infrastructure for farming in India. If it was an essential thing like fertilizer, or irrigation water or agricultural research support, then it would have been present in every state. So that is one aspect of it. And second aspect, the mandis, are they very efficient in supporting the farmers? Some of the studies have shown that mandis are not very efficient in supporting the farmers. And mandis, in fact, is an impediment to modernizing agriculture, because farmers are remaining in a comfort zone. They need to produce. They get fertilizer from there. They get credit from there. And then, you know, they offload their produce there. And they need not think about the quality. They need not think about, you know, further improving their, you know, quantity or quality, because they are made dependent on the mandi. So now, because of this liberalization, they get much better partners. Mandi is not the best partner for a farmer. The best partners are partners who know modern management, who know logistics management, who know modern marketing, and they are corporates. Mandis are not, they are not the best marketing agents. They are not best logistic managers. They are not best partners for the farmers. So mandis, let them be there. If some farmers want to give to them, let them give. Because the government of India, during the discussions, have promised that, you know, I mean, mandis can operate on their own manner, and there is no repealing of the APMC Act by any of the states so far. So as long as those laws are there, the mandis can survey, and farmers, those who want to give to mandis, let them give there and pay the 2.5% cess and the state tax and all those things, you know, let them pay there. But if farmers find another buyer where he gets 25 rupees and need not pay any cess or commission to anybody, then definitely farmer will go to such a buyer only. So freedom of choice to sell given to the farmers is much better than pegging them or tying them to APMC mandi. That is my opinion.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Any other question? Dr. Anuja, do you have any question? Yeah, okay.
Yes, sir. It was a nice talk and speech given by you on the theme. Thank you so much for that. Exactly, I wanted to know that the Essential Commodities Amendment Bill, that is 2020, seeks to remove commodities like cereals, pulses, oil seeds, edible oils, onion and potatoes from the list of essential commodities. So it means that the legislation will do away with the imposition of stock holding limits. Then how government will protect the rights of citizens if the stock holding causes price rise and black marketing?
Okay. Yeah. We have this Essential Commodities Act passed in 1955. And that time, we have a scarcity country. We were surviving on PL 480 supply of food grains from other countries. Now, we are exporting our food grains to other countries. So our wheat and rice, are they essential commodities now in Punjab and Haryana? I won't say no. They are not, but there are deficient states where they need to be reached out. That is one aspect. Second aspect, there are 23 items classified as essential commodities so far, the last being our sanitizer and face mask last year added. So so government adds or deletes items as essential commodities as per requirement. In the amended law also, there is a provision that in case of a war, in case of a famine, in case of a natural calamity, then Essential Commodities Act will come again into operation. So in emergencies, this, there is the amendment will not stand. The essential commodities will be protected, you know, the storage or whatever provisions which was existing earlier. War, famine, or natural calamities. That is one. Another is when the price rise is more than 50%, then essential commodities act will come into operation. So waiver is only when the price rise is below 50%. So when the price rise goes beyond 50% for the non-perishable foodstuffs and more than 100% for the perishable foodstuffs, then it comes into play. So it is the propaganda that Essential Commodities Act is done away with is not true, because in situations where this need to be operated, it is there. And also when the price rise is more than 50%, it will come into operation. And the storage limits also, it is done away with only for farmers, not for traders. So farmers are freed from storage restrictions. So that is the amendment. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yeah, thank you. Sir, one more apprehension is about the contract farming.
Okay.
People are saying that when small farmers enter into contract farming, they do not have the wherewithal or money or legal help to fight any legal battle if it happens before the corporate sector, who has the best resources and better legal services available for them. So how a small farmer will file the legal battle with corporate sector?
Contract farming, first of all, is not new to our country. It has been going on for the last 20, 30 years. E-Chaupal of ITC is one example, which is going very well. Gherkins is contract farming only. It is done in the south. It's going on. E-Chaupal is in the north. And also Pepsi's potato, Frito-Lay's potato, chilies, tomato. And there are several experiments and initiatives in contract farming. That's one aspect. So second aspect is, there is a dispute resolution mechanism in the new law, which says any citizen, whether a small farmer or a big farmer, he or she can go to the subdivisional magistrate. Subdivisional magistrate will refer to the reconciliation committee. And if the reconciliation committee's decision is not acceptable to the person, he can go to a court of law. So there is a remedy available for fraud or cheating or anything in the present law. That is one aspect. Second aspect, very, very important aspect, is farmers' land can never be parted with through purchase or mortgage or lease by the company which engages in contract purchase or contract with the farmer. So farmers' interests are protected. Farmer's greatest asset is his or her land. So land will never go to the corporate, whatever the terms entered in the agreement. Because the subsistence farmers may be illiterate, farmers may not have legal knowledge, no issue, their land will never go. Whatever is written by the corporate in the agreement, nothing will happen to the farmer. And only thing is, he need to see how much price. The price is the only thing the farmer need to look in the agreement. So that most of the farmers can read, you know, in letters, whether it is 30 rupees or 35 rupees. So that they can read. And if they are able to read only that much, they are protected as per the new law. It's a great law. So farmers will never lose their land. And what else they need, what else they can lose as per the contract? Nothing they will lose. Only they need to look into is the price entered in the agreement. So it's a good law. It is pro farmer. It is not pro corporate. If it was pro corporate, such a provision about land need not have been there. So it's a pro farmer law.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for alleviating many of our apprehensions. And so if there is any other question or queries from Facebook side?
No, sir. There are only compliments, so we can move ahead. Yes.
Okay. So thank you, sir. I think, sir, this will be watched again and again by millions of people. This was very interesting talk. Now I request my colleague, Dr. Rita Soni, to offer a word of thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Rita?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Jacob Thomas, for such a informative and engaging session. My dear friends and respected dignitaries, it is my pleasure for to end today's session with a vote of thanks. I strongly believe that the issues of food security and food sovereignty are the most urgent and relevant problem which needs more and more discussion as well as solutions. What I feel is, at present in India, at present context in India, we need to follow Gandhi's views, which he explained in Hind Swaraj. The fact is, Gandhi did not deny the importance of market mechanism, but he wanted the market to be in the control of communities. Mahatma Gandhi has inspired generations to maintain peace and harmony in the world. His vision of agriculture and rural development is globally acclaimed as a strategy for inclusive growth and collective governance. So the policymakers, public agencies working for agriculture and rural development in India may follow the Gandhian way to develop, to reconstruct a harmonious, poverty-free, non-violent, and self-sufficient India. So, I would like to thank my Vice Chancellor, our Vice Chancellor JNU Jagdish Kumar sir, Professor Rana Pratap Singh sir, Rector JNU, for their constant support and encouragement. And I would like to thank Professor Madhav Govind sir, Chairperson, Center for Studies in Science Policy, for organizing this program. And on behalf of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Rector, all my colleagues, and all the participants, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to our guest speaker, Dr. Jacob Thomas. And I would like to express my gratitude to all the participants who gracious this presence, and special thanks to Technical Support Team JNU for their continuous support and contribution to make the event successful. Thank you again.
Thank you, Rita. Thank you, sir. With your kind permission, sir, we would like to close this meeting.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. With your permission, ending the meeting now.
Yes.